Hi, I'm Kevin, the creator of the Mathsaurus website, and today I'm going to talk to you about how to get started with teaching maths online. So, I know there are a lot of people out there trying out teaching online for the first time because of schools being closed down because of the spread of the coronavirus. And what I want to do today is to show you some of my tips for online lessons that I've learned over the course of a few years of making videos and teaching students privately online. There are certainly some downsides to teaching online, but there are also loads of incredible opportunities and benefits and ways that you can somehow deliver, sometimes deliver even better lessons online than in person. So, as well as making videos for the Mathsaurus channel, I've got hundreds of hours of private tuition online, 7 years of teaching experience at two of London's finest academic private schools, and three master's degrees in mathematics, including an undergrad and master's from Oxford. So I hope that you'll benefit from my experience here, and from this you'll be able to be up setting up online math lessons in no time. If you're interested in finding students, or you're a student looking for an online math teacher, I'd really recommend heading over to the Tutorfair website. Please do use my affiliate link below, and they have loads of tutors there set up for online learning, and in my experience lots of students also looking for lessons. The best setup, I think, for an online lesson is going to vary a lot depending on the particular teacher and the age of the students and exactly what they're learning. I think with some structure and with some thought, you can really make it work well with most students. Although I would say that it's easiest and it works best when you have students who are quite focused and committed, and probably easier with older students than younger ones. But no reason it can't work with all of them. And one theme here is that some of the difficulties, for example, having less focused students, although we might notice them suddenly when they go online, they're often exactly the same issues we may have had in person. So do give online teaching a go, and do try to see through some of the problems to the benefit. I'm really going to talk about three main things in this video. Firstly, I'm going to show you my physical setup in terms of the equipment I've got here and what I use and what you need to get started. You don't need all of it by any means. You can get by with quite a limited setup and still give good lessons. I'm going to show you a load of online software that I use, in particular all the free stuff. In fact, more or less all the software that I use is free and open source. Thirdly, talk a little bit about setting up structures for lessons and how to make online work as a way of working and getting into good routines. So I hope it's useful. Please do put in the comments below any questions and any thoughts, and if there's enough, I'll make another video responding to them perhaps. Let me start by showing you some of the equipment. So the physical setup of your lessons is something you're going to want to think about before you start teaching. If you've got that set up, then you can have a really smooth start to the lessons and communicate just as clearly as you would do in person with students. As you can see here, I've got two monitors set up in my office, and also a tablet to write on, and there's loads of these tablets available at a wide range of budgets as well. And I should say I've put a link below to my Amazon store, and there you can see more details on all of the products that I'm using, and get them for yourself if you want to. And actually, this tablet is super easy to set up. You really just plug it into the USB, and then it works exactly like a mouse, and it lets you draw on the screen just as if you had a touchpad. Obviously, if you're doing something like making constructions where you need rulers and compasses, it's a bit more difficult, or perhaps even if you just prefer writing pen on paper instead. There is another option that I've used sometimes, which is simply to mount a webcam over the desk and to share that screen with students. And actually, that's how I did all of my lessons before I bought the tablet, and that worked pretty well as well. The main downside with that method would be that you need to scan in or take photos of the work that you've done as well if you want to share them with students, whereas with the tablet you have it straight away on the screen and you can save it really easily. Probably also want some sort of webcam to point at your face, I think, so that you can talk to the students. Most people have that built into a laptop anyway, but you can easily of course use the same webcam for that as you use for the desk if you've got a way of switching it quickly. The webcam I have on the desk is usually attached to one of these bendy mounts. In fact, I've got one here like this, and you can move this around really easily. You can point it at yourself, and you can clamp it to the desk and then point it down at the table really easily as well. Another option, if you prefer just to write pen on paper, you can get these specially built cameras like this, where you just place it on the desk, and then there's a camera here, and it will just sit over the work, and you can use that as an input to share with the student as well. So once you're set up yourself and ready to deliver online lessons, another thing you'll want to think about is what kit your students need, and do they need to have all of this stuff as well? And I think the good news is, in my opinion, they don't really need to. I think as long as you've got reasonably focused students and they've got some sort of webcam set up, the way the lessons can work perfectly well. Now, in an ideal world, perhaps they might also have a tablet, some way of writing on the screen, and there's certainly lots of options that allow you to share screens and do things like that. But it can often get a little bit complicated to do that in terms of troubleshooting, you know, tech issues and things. So I often find that it's better for me simply to have the screen and to be talking through problems with students. And some people are not convinced when I first say that this works well, but you know, if you really think about in a traditional lesson, how often you know a student is spending time at the whiteboard and how often you're there explaining things, you know, one-on-one, you actually get a lot more verbal feedback. You can talk to the student, you know, they're asking questions often the whole time, and so in practice you can get by pretty well, I say, especially with the older students, I think. But one thing that is really useful is that if they at least have some sort of camera or scanner where they've scanned in some work. So an option to still be able to see their work, for example, is for them to scan it in ahead of the lesson, and then you can bring that work up on the screen and talk through what they've done in advance. And actually, I often find, you know, it's better to look through work that students have really done and thought about and considered, rather than just that sort of high pressure moment where you're asking them a question, and they can actually, you know, that almost encourages them to come with certainly more considered questions and things as well. So there are lots of options here, but as I say, I think a relatively low tech setup on behalf of the students is probably what we should expect. It's not really reasonable to expect students to be set up with loads of tech, and I think it's better if we design our lessons and our setup in a way that can take advantage of it when they do have the tech, but is still working very well when they don't. So now I'm going to show you some of the software and some of the online tools that I use, most of which are free, to help with online lessons. And I think this really is the best part of teaching online, because unlike in person, you have access to all of your files, to the whole internet, to so many useful tools that you can use to demonstrate the ideas in maths, and to respond to things as they come up with students as well. So really does give you a lot of flexibility, and this is where in some ways, you know, it can be better than teaching in person. So okay, starting with the basics, obviously you do need some way of connecting to the student. I would tend to use Skype, but there's loads of other options available like that. I'm not going to go through those. You probably have your favorite already. The thing, you know, that I use in Skype is really the ability to share the screen with a student. Okay, so there's a button that you can click, and then the student, as well as being able to see my face through my webcam, can see the output of my second monitor and everything that I write there in a window on their screen as well. But the most important thing is, you know, what do we put on to that second monitor? And the first piece of software that I really want to talk about is called OpenBoard. OpenBoard is a totally free piece of software, and as you can see, as I'm demonstrating it here, you can have the software open on one screen, and then it puts the actual whiteboard over onto a second monitor. So it also makes it great for use in physical classrooms as well, where you can have your PC and the physical whiteboard in the room separately, so you can have access to all of the tools and other things on the screen, and the student just gets to see the clean finished whiteboard. It's got loads of really handy tools in it as well, and it does it all really nice and simply. So for example, you can just you know, do a snip of any area of the screen and copy it straight into OpenBoard. Once you finish the lesson, you can just very quickly turn all of the slides that you've been using into a PDF. Again, another situation where we have an advantage over real classrooms here. You know, you don't ever, you know, you can write several whiteboards worth of material, and you can go back and forth between the notes you've written in that lesson without having to rub them off. You can easily pull in questions from exam papers and diagrams without having to spend loads of time sitting and with the students waiting for you to draw them. So one thing I'll make use of a lot in lessons is the website Desmos, a really good intuitive graphing tool, and all online, so you don't need to download anything to use this. You can get it very easily to plot graphs, x squared, x cubed, x to the 4, whatever you want to. You can do much harder things as well, obviously, but really easy to put something in there. And then if you're using OpenBoard, as I suggested before, again, you know, I can just, you know, take a graph from here, say add to current page, and I can put it straight into my notes and onto the whiteboard that I'm sharing with the students. Lots of little fun things that are built into here as well. I think if you type in Betcha Can't, it'll come up with a, I'll say challenge accepted, and it'll come up with a an interesting animation. Looks like we've got some sort of Pac-Man style thing here, and it's all been made, as you can see, in mathematical notation. So lots of fun things for students to look at and explore in there. Okay, here's JoJoBra, another totally free tool, another one I use quite a lot. I mean, they have graphing things as well, and initially I knew this is a tool for doing geometry, but it's extended into a lot more now. I actually use it a lot for its little app on probability distributions here, which is great for A-level maths in particular. You know, you can just put in all sorts of distributions. We've got the normal distribution here, but there's a whole list of different distributions it can come up with, and you can use it to calculate probabilities and demonstrate the ideas there. And again, really easily copy it into your whiteboard with OpenBoard. So here's Wolfram Alpha. I guess loads of people know about this website already, but a super powerful computational engine. You know, I can tell it to, you know, work out all of these derivatives or whatever, and you can just type a function in and wait for it to do some computation. It will, you know, really come up with a lot of information on those things. Again, interesting to get answers in itself, but then also usually gives you some other output to explore and to think about that can motivate further questions. You can ask it to tell you a joke, and it will tell you a joke with some sort of mathematical background in here. Some of these are, you know, some of these use slightly more advanced math than some of our students will be ready for, but you know, still quite a nice little feature. And another nice thing is, of course, if you've got any bespoke materials that you've made for classes in the past, or I didn't make this one, but here's a, you know, an explanation of a regression line that has come from some slightly older resources here, but it's great to be able to type in data and to play around with those ideas. And when you're online, you have access to all of this stuff all at your fingertips, if you're just a little bit organized with your files and folders. And the last thing I'd really advise you to get hold of is something like this, one of the calculator emulators. Now, this is not free to individuals. I think it costs about £10 to have the license from Casio, but you may have access to it for free if you're also working for a school or something. But what this allows you to do is to, you know, to show the calculator exactly as the student will be using it. I know a lot of people use these in physical classrooms these days on the screen as well, but I can really touch all of the buttons on the calculator exactly as you touch the real one, and, you know, I can go here and show them how to use the calculator to solve a quadratic equation, and if they've got their calculator in person, they can sort of follow along with it as the explanation goes on. If you see my videos on the Mathsaurus channel, you'll see me using this quite a bit in those videos as well. So once you've got your physical setup sorted and your online software all ready to go, the last thing to think about is, I think, actually how you're going to manage the day-to-day experience of the students in terms of setting them work, making sure they've got access to resources and all of that sort of stuff. And this is another area where the online lessons really can work a lot better. So there's loads of other options apart from Google Drive, but here's one that I tend to use Google Drive for my students because it's free, a lot of people are used to it, but there are other options available. And you can share a particular folder there with a student, so they have access just to that folder here. So I've made one called Teaching Maths Online, and within that you can have subfolders that they can see. So you could have a folder where they upload their work, and then you could tell them every week if you have a lesson on a Wednesday, they have to upload some work you've given to them by Tuesday. You could easily do this with a whole class if you had a folder for each of them that you could share with them individually without the others being able to see their work as well. Then you can go through that in the next lesson, and you can put your comments, or you can mark it if you want to and put it back in this folder so they can see your comments before the lesson, however you want to work. I mean, in practice, I think actually marking work with the students, whilst they're watching it and you can talk about it is really good. I think a common misconception we have in teaching sometimes is somehow that if it involves us more work, it must be better for the students. But I think marking is a great example where actually somehow if you do it with them, it's a much more engaging process and a more useful process for both parties. We still have to mark exams, we still have to mark other work sometimes, but online this can work really well because we have this sort of, it's like we have this shared project that we're working on, this shared with all these shared folders and documents, and somehow the students can take a bit more ownership of it sometimes as well. Okay, so that's one thing. And I think a second thing as well that has come up for me is scheduling lessons. And obviously when we're in person, you turn up and you're there and they're there, and that's all very easy. Whereas somehow online, it's a bit easy for students to say they've forgotten the lesson or not turn up and have all the timings right. So another really useful feature is to do something like using a Google Calendar invite where you're both invited by email and you both accept it, and then it appears in your lessons, and if you have notifications on your phone, as most students do now, they'll get a notification 15 minutes before the lesson reminding them automatically. Gets rid of a lot of problems like that. Again, this works, but it's particularly useful, I think, if you have students who operate in different time zones, as I do sometimes. Google will do all that, admin of matching up. Is it 3 p.m. here when it's 6 p.m. somewhere else, and all that sort of stuff. Okay, so I hope this has been useful to those of you thinking about setting up online math lessons, whether that's because you're forced into it because of the situation we have at the moment with the coronavirus, or because it's something you're looking to do for online one-on-one tuition, or for whatever other reason. There are some disadvantages to online tuition. I think it's somehow you don't quite get always the sort of personal interaction that you get in person, but as we've seen, you've got somehow access to all of these online tools and websites, and it can really make scheduling easier as well. You can be at home, you don't have to travel between students if you're a private tutor, and so I do think that online tuition can work just as well, if not a lot better, for some students. It's certainly allowed me to teach students who are very far away in different parts of the world, who have more demanding schedules, or sometimes I'll have students who have a combination of in-person lessons and some extra support online, and there's loads of ways that can work really well. And I'm sure over the coming month, lots of people are going to be experimenting with this and finding out exactly how it might work for them. So please do put in the comments if you've got any questions or things to discuss. Maybe if it gets a lot of response, I'll do another video on this, replying to some of these things. Also, if you're new to my channel, the Mathsaurus website and the YouTube channel, I've got hundreds of videos at GCSE and A level that I made whilst teaching in schools in London. There's loads of past papers, there's questions by topic for every topic, from old exam questions for IGCSE, linked to video solutions in most cases. I do a lot of stuff for the Oxford Maths Admissions Test, and I'm doing a lot of Cambridge STEP questions at the moment, so please do share those with your students, and feel free to use them in your online teaching if they're useful. I've put all of the links to the products that I've talked about in this video in an Amazon store below as well, and linked, as I said before, to Tutorfair if you want to do some online teaching there and find some students there. And I'll put links to all of the free websites in the description below as well. So I really hope that's useful. Good luck with your online studies, and I hope to hear from some of you in the comments.